Okay, folks, so you've got yourself the GC Titan Ridge card, and this card is not working in your computer, so what do you do? Well, it turns out there is a hack, and one of these hacks is to essentially force short pins 1 and 3. So essentially what you're going to be doing is you can either use a paperclip, you can solder the wires together, you can just get some wire from your existing selection of wires, or just cut up a little connector pin that comes with the card and make this little loop right here going from pin 1 to pin 3. Keep in mind that this will be basically reversed if you flip the card over, but I'll put a picture on the screen here in a little bit to show you what mine looks like as I ended up just soldering the two wires that are coming out of the unit together. And this will now allow the actual board to show up on your computer so that you can update the firmware, you can update the drivers, etc., etc., without actually needing to have a specific header that connects into your motherboard itself, because this essentially creates that header connection without you actually having to have that feature on the motherboard at all, which means that it will work potentially on almost any motherboard. Again, depending on, you know, sort of how the motherboard was configured, because there are certain PCI bus issues that we could run into later, but we'll cross that bridge when we get there. All right, folks, so you've made your header mod that will allow the GC Titan Ridge card to run. Now, the next step that we're going to do here is we're going to go ahead and grab two of these drivers from this website in here. I will link it in the description below. If you're going to be using the version 1.0 of the card, you'll respectively want to get the lowest end version of that driver for the 1.0. This will allow us to perform the firmware downgrade needed to get this card operational. Now, initially, most of these will ship with .50 firmware, so we're going to be downgrading to version 23 in order to get it to run on motherboards that are otherwise not compatible. So let's see it in action. Okay, guys, so at this point, what you'll see is a little screen like this as you run the installer. Now, typically, this will run through the steps kind of one by one, and then it will eventually ask you to restart the computer, and that's exactly what you're going to want to do at this point. All right, next step is going to be installing the Thunderbolt controller. Now, this particular piece of software on my first install basically popped up on its own. The second time I did this, I had to actually go to this Microsoft store link before it popped open for me, and I was able to actually proceed with seeing all of my hardware in this little profile pane. So do just that, go ahead and grab that software now, and we can continue on with the next steps. This next step is equally as important. You will likely see a little pop-up section that will ask you to approve the device that you want to have plugged in. In my case, you can see my Razer Core enclosure, so I'm going to click in there, and I'm going to click Always Allow It to be Plugged In, and this will allow this device to function properly, and you'll need to do the same thing if you happen to restart your computer. So post restart, you may see a screen like this where you finally show the device being connected, and in theory, when you open Device Manager, you should no longer be seeing any exclamation point marks. Now, you may still need one more restart, but also at this point, it is very likely that you will want to update the driver for this entire situation so that you can see in here, I have that firmware revision, but also now the newer driver being installed. So this is going to be really crucial for some systems, while others you can leave on the same driver that we installed in the beginning. All right, ladies and gentlemen, so yes, I do realize it is an absolute mess down there, but as you can see, the Razer Core is working, and if we actually come over back to the computer over here, I'm going to go ahead and launch AverMedia because that's where my card is. The card is actually, in fact, connected, and if we take a look over here, you can very clearly see AverMedia is running. Now, it is currently actively asking for no input signal because there's actually nothing connected to it. However, as we can see, if we come down here. All right, you guys, now at this point, you're probably wondering why go through all the trouble of putting in a Thunderbolt device in your PC that does not normally support it? And the answer is there are a number of really big benefits. For me personally, I'm using a Razer Core X. This is one of the earlier models. And one of my favorite features is that I can actually pull out all of my hardware and use it. In this case, you can see I've got the AverMedia recording card in there. It's the 4K capture card, and this makes it really easy for me to swap out components in here. So if for whatever reason I wanted to put in NVMe drives in this and another GPU without having to basically completely discombobulate my whole computer, I can do that using this enclosure. It also means that if I'm ever in need for additional really fast storage and I end up getting, for example, a video camera that happens to be, let's say, using the CF Express type card format, then I can also get an additional NVMe type or PCIe type drive that supports that sort of CF card enclosure, and then I can put that in here and run it all over a 40 gigabit link, which is of course massive, because otherwise the only support I have is for USB 3.1 on my motherboard, which obviously gets to like a theoretical basically 10 gigabits, I believe, and that's not exactly ideal. So again, this is just much faster. It is also actually faster than the 10 gigabit link that I would otherwise have between my computers when running over my 10G fiber network. Now, this in and of itself is also the possibility for adding additional components into the PC that you otherwise would not have. And of course, the fact that this is running on an AMD Ryzen system, of all other things, is just massive. It's huge, huge for anybody who's trying to do this. And the fact that this card costs about $90, depending on where you take it from, sometimes maybe even cheaper if you go on eBay. These Gigabyte GC Titan Ridge cards are stupid cheap nowadays, and you can have yourself a really awesome either eGPU or NVMe storage setup for only, you know, $80 to $70, and you're rocking. So until next video, I'll see you guys.